I want to welcome everyone here tonight to the Kofler Auditorium at the University of Toronto. My name is Peter Lowen. I'm the director of the Center for the Study of the United States at the Monk School of Global Affairs. Among our major initiatives this year is a lecture series on inequality in the United States. And we have four lectures, in fact, going on over the year. I'll tell you about the others before I introduce our distinguished guest. Christopher Hedges will be giving a lecture later this fall. We'll have a lecture from Richard Florida, who we're very lucky to have here at the University of Toronto, who'll be speaking on inequality in American cities. And the great chronicler of working class life in America and the working poor, Barbara Ehrenreich, will be giving a talk near the end of November. We're doing this in partnership with the University of British Columbia, who are convening a similar series of lectures with the Nobel laureate Joe Stiglitz, Teju Cole, Bill McKibben, and with Andrew Sullivan. All those lectures will be available on a joint website that you can find out about, I guess, when it's up. But certainly, if you're subscribed to the CSUS mailing list, we can tell you about it. Enough of that business. I want to tell you that it's my great pleasure to welcome Ralph Nader to the University of Toronto. Ralph Nader really exploded into public consciousness in 1965 with the publication of his book, Unsafe at Any Speed. And I think if you looked at the things that made Mr. Nader notable at that point in time, a mastery of facts, a good sense of what would be in the public interest and what would be interesting to the public, a real suspicion of corporate power, and at the same time a very deep belief in the democratic ideals of the United States. If you saw all those things in him that made him so notable in 1965, you would find that those are the same things that make him so notable today, some 50 years later. It would take all of the time we have allotted to mention all the books that Mr. Nader has written. I'll mention just two. He wrote a wonderful book co-written named Canada Firsts, about all the things that Canada has done that I guess America hasn't in some sense. If you want to feel good about being Canadian, it's not always easy. It's a great book to read. And he's, with a collection of other authors, published a new book called Canada After Harper, which will be available for sale outside. Now, the way things will go tonight is Mr. Nader will speak, and then he will take questions. He's a formidable person, so he's going to do all that on his own without any need for moderation from me. You've heard enough from me. Please join me in thanking to the University of Toronto, Ralph Nader.
Thank you very much, Peter. Thank you all for coming. Looking you over, I think you could change Canada all by yourself here, which is one of my central points. That it takes, and I might as well say it at the outset, based on historical change dynamics in peaceful societies, we're not talking about wars, it takes about 1% or less of the people seriously engaged and geographically distributed throughout the ridings, or in our case, the districts, reflecting existing or quickly shaped majority public opinion to change the other 1%, the Wall Street 1%. Sometimes it takes considerably less than that, depending on who you have in the parliament. But it is an expression of widespread powerlessness that also exaggerates the formidable nature of the opposition. So when you're powerless, the opposition looks like a credible mountain. But the more power you organize at the community base, the less formidable it becomes. And this is a very important point because progressives, or whatever you want to call them, are infinitely capable of rationalizing their own futility on that basis. I don't want to minimize the opposition. I don't want to minimize how it adjusts to being defeated on the second round and third round. But I want to point out that when you come to this realization, and we can talk about all the things in your history and our history, you become subjected to a much higher level of morale. And you become possessed of thinking you can actually accomplish it with your fellow citizens. And so you move. You don't rationalize futility. You don't say whatever will be, you don't say you can't take on City Hall. You move because it doesn't seem to be so insuperable. And it's very important to keep hammering at with your friends, and when they challenge you, just give them history. How many people did it take to get Canadian Medicare established? First in Saskatchewan and then nationwide. That question is almost never asked. How many people, other than the parliaments? If Tommy Douglas wasn't born from his parents, would it have happened? How many more came to the support of Tommy Douglas? In different levels. Some worked their heads off with him. Some spent a few hours a month with him. And some just let themselves be known to pollsters that they're on his side. I know when I ask myself all the battles we've been in, we never came close to 1% seriously engaged, defined as 200 to 300 hours a year, informed, connected to one another through districts and ridings throughout the country, and raising enough money to have a full-time office with 2 to 3, 4 advocates to spearhead the process, because the backup 1%, they go to work, they have other things, they can't do it full-time, so they support people in every district or riding full-time, and then they have some full-time advocates at the parliament, all around the parliament. So here in Canada, for example, look at what has been accomplished just from Duff Conacher. How many of you have heard of Duff Conacher? You know, go to Democracy Watch and you'll see what he's done. He spent a year with us in Washington, and he learned the fundamentals of the prerequisites of democracy and specific modes. And he just has been a one-man watchdog, advocate, draftsperson, getting things through through Parliament and government accountability, ethics. He's not responsible for implementing them. That's another job. That's the job of the executive and so forth. But he took it to that level, and he did a lot of work on banks and preventing bank mergers and preventing the kind of things from happening that brought down our banking industry on the backs of 8 million unemployed workers and trillions of dollars of lost pension and mutual fund money and the whole taxpayer bailout of Wall Street in 2008-2009. So where the conventional treatment of inequality is, you start with the data, right? Like 50% of the Canadians now make less than Canadians made in the late 70s, inflation adjusted. Or in the United States, it's about 80%. And you go into unemployment, underemployment, you go into shrinkages or destruction of pensions, you go into concentration ratios, the top 1% of wealth in the U.S., wealthy people, have equivalent wealth to the combined wealth of the bottom 95%. Just think of that, 95%. And you go through all these, and we're supposed to become enraged. And then you reify them, you personalize it. You say, you know, I remember being in South Carolina, and I went into Beaufort County, and there were kids with rickets. They were so hungry and so nutritionally deprived. All over the country, every week in the United States, 800 people die because they can't afford health insurance to get diagnosed or treated in time. And according to the Occupational Safety and Health Agency, which we got through Congress in 1970, there are 60,000 workplace-related deaths and injuries from trauma and disease every year. That's over 1,000 a week. And there are 100,000 people who die from hospital malpractice, according to the Harvard School of Public Health. And 65,000 Americans die every year from air pollution, just from half of it from coal burning, And that's the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency. And you go through all these, and people just glaze, right? It doesn't mean anything. And then when you put proper names on them and put a human face on them, they become a little bit more interested. It's like that little boy, that Syrian boy that was washed up on the ocean, on the shore in Turkey, I guess. And we've all seen corpses of little kids piled up all over the world, you know, adults battling each other and killing their own kids and being killed by empire wielders like Washington, D.C., and presidents and so forth, didn't register like that little boy. Even caught Stephen Harper's attention for other reasons, because it embarrassed his government in terms of refugee entry from areas of chaos. I'm going to go the other way. I'm going to say that it's a natural tendency of human populations not to kill each other. It's a natural tendency to be fairly accommodating neighbors, to grow enough food, build enough shelter, produce enough clothing, provide enough transportation, provide enough health care, income security, and so on. And that really is a majority viewpoint when you really come down to it. Against that is the anthropological findings that every culture, every society ever studied in the world has its 1%. Isn't that interesting? It is cross-cultural, cross-religious, cross-ethnic. You go anywhere in the world, and 1% of the people have most of the power. And so when there's a total dictatorship, a complete totalitarian dictatorship, that dictatorship has even less than 1% business people, oligarchs, and so on, military around them. So it's not a unique phenomena. It's something all human populations have to struggle against. It is not idiosyncratic to any race, color, creed, or geography. And that means it's important to go to origins. And while it may appear intellectually soft to go to these origins, I submit that's where the problems of inequality begin. They begin by permissive acceptance of growing inequality by those who are victimized. That's where it grows. Otherwise, the perpetrators couldn't get to first base. And the incentives are quite different. The incentives for the perpetrators are a lust for power and a lust for material greed. And those are very powerful motivators, let's face it. They are powerful for several reasons. One is they are very personal to the acquisitor, let's call it the person, inquisitor. And second is that they produce fear by the acquisitor, which propels the acquisitor to pile up more money. It could be fear or envy. That is often the genesis of local and national dictatorships. The more power they take, the more they fear from the people who hate them. And so they take more power, and they take more power. And it's a protective mechanism. We often don't give dictators that level of indulgence, do we? But they're afraid too. And they don't know where they're going to sleep at night, some of them, as they have different abodes and circle around with their security teams. So when those motives, and they're very simple, they're very visceral, greed, power, when they collide against civic values, there's a different texture to the motivation. Civic values are more communal, they're more cranial, they're more tolerant. Up against the tight organizational plutocracies and oligarchies, they're no match unless they are organized. And unfortunately, most civic values are sort of public opinion. You know, people will say, yeah, you know, they like peace, they like living wage, they like health insurance coverage, they like child care, they like affordable education. and so on. Those are civic values. But are they organized the way the values of greed and power are organized? And the answer is very rarely. But when it does happen, and it often comes in from what is called people who call themselves liberals, progressives, conservatives, doesn't matter. Once you get to that level, they want the same things. The divide and rule tactics that polarize societies are controlling processes by a few over the many. Like in Washington, you never end up hearing every hour of the day that we live in a red state country and a blue state country. Yeah, the red states, you know, are Mississippi, Arkansas, Texas, Oklahoma, and the blue states are Massachusetts, New York, California, Oregon, Washington State, and so on. And so people swallow it. They believe it. Why? Because it has a core of truth to it. They are divided on things like reproductive rights. They're divided on things like, you know, the Confederate flag being flown. They're divided on a misconceived sense of overregulation in many areas. You remember, I don't know whether it floated over the border, but when the Tea Party was organized and they said, we hate big government, we want to get rid of big government, and one of the criers said, but don't touch our Medicare. But it's true. Well, of course, that supersedes ideology, right? When you're sick, you want Medicare. You want health care. So here's where it starts. It starts in our schools where children are taught to believe and not to think. They're taught to memorize. They're taught to absorb what they memorize, so they vegetate. They're taught not to challenge. They're taught to accept. That's where it all starts. They are taught computer programming. They are not taught civic skills. When they're taught civics, it's rote memorization on how the government's supposed to operate. The ministries, the election, first past the post, and you know, all that stuff. It's just the way it's supposed to go. Historically, they are not taught about the great dissenters. At least the great dissenters, the great change forces, people are minimized. They're taught about politicians who win great elections. They're taught about generals and admirals. They're taught about people basically who use force, like to open up the West. I went one time I was 10 years old, and I came home and I excitedly told my father, maybe I was a little younger than that, that I've just learned who discovered America. And he said, who? I said, Columbus. And he said, Columbus didn't discover America. He invaded America. And there were people there that he and his cohort slaughtered in the Caribbean. And yet, look it, they still study Columbus as the discoverer of America and have Columbus Day, which is a holiday. So here's what happens in our educational process. We graduate, we don't have a clue on how to be a practicing citizen, which is one reason half the people in the States don't even bother voting. Because they say, what should I vote for? It doesn't mean anything to me. They're going to do whatever they want. They're all crooks or, you know, I'm too busy, I'm working, I'm commuting. You know all the reasons. It's not that much better here in Canada. And so what they do is they reduce their own significance as citizens down to almost absolute zero. They basically accept what is given them, and they are very vulnerable to a twisted definition of freedom. And you say to people in the United States, you live in a free country? They're darn right. Now you get rid of some big government, we'll be even freer. And you say, well, what do you mean by being free? There's no distinction between personal freedom and civic freedom. Yeah, even in dictatorships, there's a lot of personal freedom. And in Canada and the US, This is personal freedom. You can pick your friends. You can eat whatever you want. You can download whatever music you want. You can travel here and there. You can choose your clothing. You can decide what books you want to read. You can choose your university within limits. You can pick what kind of work you want to do in life. You can decide when to cut the grass, shovel the sidewalk. You can decide when you want to grumble and have to go out of your front door because you got to go down to some box to collect a letter because the postal union rolled the Canadian people and showed me that they were more apathetic than I ever dreamed of, that they allow something like that, which is going to lead to a lot of falls and hip breaks and discomfort for what? So anyway, you're free to do all these things. You're free to even tell the prime minister off. That's not civic freedom. Civic freedom can be defined by Marcus Cicero. Cicero, over 2,000 years ago, defined freedom as participation in power. That's the definition of freedom. It's not freedom to choose an app. It's not freedom to send a text message. They send plenty of text messages in China. They send plenty of text messages in dictatorships around the world. Civic freedom means that in a variety of ways, between and at elections, you participate in decisions that affect you. Whatever touches all should be decided by all is an old Roman adage. Now, obviously you can't decide everything like direct democracy, a parliament of 25 million Canadian adults on every issue. There's a delegation there. But in our countries, there's been delegation run riot, total riot. First of all, it's a delegation to larger and larger populated districts. So you have 535 members of Congress. You had it when there is 80 million people, well, a little less because Alaska and Hawaii were not states, but roughly, now you have 330 million people, 535 members of Congress. The delegation comes also by the interference of money in politics. And that blurs the significance of even a good vote by your standards. And there's a delegation by way of mystery, the mystery of the legislative process, of the regulatory process, the legal jargon that provides lawyers with their monopolistic inventory. There are all kinds of ways. And then once you get past the parliament and the legislature, then the delegation is stretched out like a rubber band beyond belief. It goes to the executive branches, the departments of defense, which is a huge world by itself. It goes to agencies, innumerable agencies. They then delegate it further by private contracting. You call it privatization. By outsourcing half of the Pentagon's war making costs, and then it goes in even worse than that. At the state level, it goes to wholly unaccountable public authorities and public districts, and people don't even know their names, and what neighborhoods are in what public districts. So you see, by the time the rubber band stretches, where is the average citizen? The average citizen is basically out of it. The average citizen plunges into their personal lives to try to make the best of it. And you can see it. Making the best of it is trying to get a good job, trying to maneuver your convenience and getting back and forth in daycare, trying to get a decent pension, trying to have an interesting workplace, and the rest of the time is dealing with family life and entertainment. And entertainment now is taking up more and more time because that, again, is almost a relief factor, a frustration at the end of the day. Just plop down, look at a TV movie or sports or whatever. And that's the, those are the areas where parents don't have enough time for their children. Children are now spending less time with adults than any children in human history. Now, you know, some people may say that's a blessing. And certainly McDonald's believes that with its proverbial adage, it's a child's world. They tell children in direct marketing to children, bypassing and undermining the authority of parents. You want to talk about radical extremism? Try that one. That one comes in, the condemnation of direct marketing to children comes in over 90%. Left, right, doesn't matter. There's a left-right convergence in the United States on most of the important issues confronting the country. Part of it on the military side is fudge because the information flow is not good. When it is good, when some of these soldiers come back and tell what really happened in Iraq, the right wing listens to them. Has to be the messenger, the right messenger. But on areas like corporate welfare or crony capitalism, 80-90%, breaking up the big New York banks that are too big to fail, 90%, cracking down on corporate crime, fraud, and abuse, that's in the 90%, even in raising the minimum wage, which has turned into an ideological battle for years, it comes in 70-80% right now in the United States. That means a lot of conservative Walmart workers. You can't have 70-80% without having a lot of people call themselves conservatives. Civil liberty violations and the so-called Patriot Act, that comes in over 80%. People do not like police to search their homes and not have to tell them for 72 hours that they searched their homes. They don't like the idea of the police without probable cause getting into your medical and financial records. And so if you get rid of this divide and rule for the moment, you will see that there's an incredible convergence, and I suggest probably a lot of it is the same in Canada. And when that convergence occurs, and it starts out with public opinion, and then it moves into visibility, marches, demonstrations, polling that is very specific, gets to the members of parliament, and then when it moves into the civic organizational area, and then when some candidates pick it up, it's unstoppable. It doesn't matter how powerful the corporations are. It's unstoppable. I've seen it happen with a number of pieces of legislation, the auto safety legislation, unanimous through Congress. A year before that, 1964, 65, if you said to members of Congress that there's going to be unanimous vote to regulate the most powerful industry in the United States, they would have sent you to psychiatry. That's what happens when you have a left-right alliance. The problem with progressives is they can't stand to talk this way because they can't stand to work with right-wingers because they hate them on things like reproductive rights. It's the yuck factor. Never mind all the other things. Even on the military-industrial complex, where did that phrase come from? Came from a conservative called General Dwight Eisenhower, who became a president in his farewell address. The military-industrial complex, once you break it down and you say to right-wingers all over the country, hey, you want that bridge repaired that you've been bitching about? Do you want that school upgraded for your kids? Are you upset about drinking water that comes in less than what H2O should look like in your faucet? Wouldn't you like some decent daycare that you don't have to pay, catch this, $400 a week in many cities? How can a family afford that? Just for daycare. That's what the U.S. government allows a company to come on the premises of the U.S. Department of Environment and government employees park their children there, $19,000 a year. They take it. They take it. The rubber band doesn't snap. The job of people who advocate for a democratic society that delivers is to make sure that rubber band snaps quicker before it becomes an irreversible subordination in the minds of millions of people who give up. You know, people who, when they're asked in a mass gathering, what's the difference between, you know, think of a stadium full. What's the difference between apathy and ignorance? They answer, I don't care and I don't know. That means they've given up on themselves. You see it in West Virginia and the hollows of Kentucky. They're completely exploited beyond belief. Toxic water, toxic air, incredible poverty, addictive products pushed on them, on and on and on. It's a rich land with poor people, you know, coal and all the rest. And they vote right wing. They vote for Republicans. There's a great book called Deer Hunting with Jesus that you should read to understand why they do that. And part of the understanding is when Senator Inhofe from Oklahoma, who thinks that global climate change is a hoax and has challenged the Democrats to a debate and he can't find anyone. How about that? For the yuck factor. He's in charge of the relevant committee now in the Senate. Once, years ago, he was asked, I guess he didn't know someone was listening, but some people said, Jim, how do you win these elections constantly? It's that simple. It's all about God, gays, and guns. That's how he wins them. Read Deer Hunting with Jesus, written by someone who grew up there. He's a better read than Hunter Thompson. Brilliant writer. So we go back to the schools and the parents and the commercialization of everything. The struggle in a democracy is who is going to gain the mantle of supremacy? Commercial values or civic values? That's the tension. And whenever civic values are subordinated to commercial values, you get NAFTA, you get WTO, you get Stephen Harper, you get the deterioration of the Canadian consensus. You get the deterioration, two-tier health care, you get deterioration environment. You get rid of environmental assessments for the mining industry. You cut the CBC budget, on and on. When commercial values are subordinated to civic values, look what you get. You get environmental laws. You get consumer protection laws. You get prosecution of corporate criminals. You get beefed up budgets and enforcement, which is one way corporate lobbyists turn good laws into no-law laws, because they strangle the enforcement budgets. No investigators, very few prosecutors, other than, you know, the war on drugs and the war on terror and so on. When civic values are subordinated to commercial values or corporate commercial values, you get an abolition of child labor in the United States over 100 years ago. You get the Fair Labor Standards Laws. You get the Kellogg-Briand Peace Treaty that outlawed war that we belong to, and it's still on the books. What a dead letter in the 1920s. And what do the commercial values do when they lose? And when they know that they're going to confront a defiant public consensus and a sufficient level of enforcement if they try to wiggle out in succeeding years. What they do is they adjust. Corporations have very few convictions. They're expedient. They're opportunistic. We should give them repeated opportunities to be expedient and opportunistic. Once we lay down the law, it's represented by public sentiment, they adjust. If they don't adjust, alternative models displace them. Legitimate cooperatives displace them. Other institutions that deliver economic services displace them, like local economies that are becoming more and more robust over the U.S., you know, community health clinics and local renewable energy and farmer-to-consumer marketplaces and community banks and local transportation entities. And each dollar that is spent with these local businesses, who are never going to threaten to leave, close down, unemployed people, and go to China or Indonesia or whatever, every dollar spent takes it away from the Bank of America, from ExxonMobil, et cetera. Every solar panel that's put up does the same thing. So you get displacement. Traditionally, our countries have tried to make corporations behave by regulation, by litigation, or by prosecution, or by elections. The most powerful way is displacement. You develop a displacement economy that becomes a erosion of the basic nutrients for a multinational corporate economy, which are consumer dollars and taxpayer dollars. They use the taxpayer dollars, obviously, for diminishing their risk-taking because they put it on the back of taxpayers, and you have bailouts, handouts, bailouts, all kinds of corporate welfare, which is about half of what Washington does these days. There's so many programs, they don't even catalog them. Market quotas and so forth. And if you have civic values triumphing, you don't have a federal U.S. budget that is 50% devoted to military. Can you imagine? It's no more Soviet Union. China's not interested in sending missiles here, not as long as we send our jobs and industries there. And yet, 50% of the gargantuan federal budget, aside from Medicare, Medicaid, you know, the health insurance part, goes to military. It's actually more than that if you take in the Nuclear Regulatory Commission part, the Veterans Administration of past wars, the costs of past wars, and the like. So what do we do at the roots? Here's what we do. Who can stop us? Stop making excuses for ourselves. One is we can go to our schools and say, we want civic training courses. There are all kinds of civic groups can teach it. You don't have to add new teachers if the teachers are not equipped or the bureaucracy is not willing. You have it done that way, or you do it after school. Doesn't take long with very idealistic and inquisitive 10th graders. You want to really discomfort a politician in North America, confront them with 10 10th graders to ask questions. One time, Reagan was completely bamboozled when a 10-year-old went up to him and asked him, Mr. Reagan, what are the sources of pollution? And he says, well, they're mostly trees. 80% of pollution comes from trees. There were other questions, too. There's a whole book called Reagan's Reign of Error by Mark Green, R-E-I-G-N. You could do one now for your, you know. So now you want to do fundamental things that are easy to do, that no one can really stop you. And most of the things in building a strong democracy get you halfway there. Half a democracy is showing up, let's face it. How many of you have tried, and you wouldn't be here if you weren't reasonably active, have tried to get people out to a march, a demonstration, a lecture, a town meeting, whatever you call it here in Canada, and you're not trying to persuade them about something they don't believe in. You have a call list where there are people who agree with you. And they have 100 excuses. I got to do this, and I got to take that. And so you don't have time for democracy. You're going to be busier than ever on other things that you don't like to do. Misery, anxiety, poverty, deprivation, make work are the consequences of injustice and worse. And if you don't develop a sense of injustice at a young age, you will not have a cultivated sense of justice. And if you don't have a cultivated sense of justice, you cannot build a democratic society. And so all these children are being robotized into immorality at best, and indifference in the face of raw brutality and coarseness at worst. So how hard is it to choose, to turn around? Let's go back to the 1%. Let's say 240,000 adult Canadians distributed all over the ridings decided they were going to change Canada. Okay? How many people you think watch the world, you know, the hockey league, the cup? You get 130 million Americans watch the Super Bowl. They before, during, and after the Super Bowl, that's about, you know, 1.5 billion hours. There aren't 1.5 billion hours devoted to Congress, which spends 22% of their income, can send their children to war, can allow corporations to take over their lives right down to controlling their privacy, and can wreck the country by what it doesn't do as well as it does do in the tax system and like. There isn't 1.5 billion hours coming in on Congress by informed, determined citizens coordinated in 10 years. See how much opportunity we have for a slight diversion from entertainment to significance? 1%. You can start exiting the 99%. Well, there are 15-20% of the people who are so seriously challenged with their disabilities or their children, they don't have an hour to spend. And there are X percent that this and X percent that. You still don't get close to 1% of available people who have the information and the know-how to get one major redirection after another done. This is what this book's about. Apart from its title, it's 21 experts, and they're not just study experts, a lot of them are activists, in almost every facet of the Canadian political economy. And they basically say, look, here's what's happened, and it's getting worse, and here's what some people are doing about it, and we're going to suggest the directions. Now, the one thing this book doesn't have, it doesn't go to the level of actual civic practice. And this is my criticism of schools of public policy, and I came out of some myself, that it's all public policy. It's public policy. We also need schools of public practice. How do you get it done? Once you have the right policy. And once you have the right policy, in quotes, and you start trying to get it done, the feedback will get you a better policy while you're trying to get it done. It's called empirical nourishment, replacing empirical starvation. Come to the parents. Can't parents organize and begin shielding their children from commercial upbringing? Corporations are raising our children. They are direct marketing to the level of tens of billions of dollars. Everything that's bad for the children. What kind of culture is it that we have to have parental shields from the main commercial culture, pumping junk food and junk drink and early obesity into these children, turning their tongues against their brain, harassing the parents? They actually, the ads teach the kids how to harass their parents and make them feel guilty because they can't spend enough time and they're commuting. I want the Nintendo. No, I want to sit down, says mommy, and build and play with you with building blocks. It doesn't cost anything. I want the Nintendo. Because they see it on TV. And the ads get prizes on Madison Avenue by having what's called, quote, this is the trade moniker, a high nag factor. End quote, a high nag factor. This one will get the kids to nag at 80% likelihood of the parents. This is electronic child molestation. And that's what we should call it. Just think of the death and injury and disease and expense from obesity itself. They know what they're doing. The fat food, fat chains, they know what they're doing. They know what they're pumping into these kids. They know how to seduce their taste. They know how to generate rebellion at the dinner table again and again. I don't want this. I don't like this. I hate this. What do you want? A Coke. You want a Coke for breakfast? Why do you get indignant on this? Because you know the facts. You know that it's premeditated. It's not just a free market. You can go into the supermarket, Loblaws, and pick some good things and pick some bad things. It's a free country. This is a systematic, strategic plan by the food industry to maximize the sales and the repeated sales of food that gives them the most profit with the lowest price to the consumer. That's what they're doing. They're pricing the most dangerous foods lower than the better foods because they are looking for addiction. They are looking for repeat purchases by the addicted consumer population. That has been documented physiologically, Yale and other places. They know what they're doing. And we better know what they're doing. Here's a way you can avoid accusations of conspiracy theory. It's like they don't work together. Okay, let's say it's not a conspiracy. Let's say it's just strategic planning. And can anybody deny, empirically, that the first priority of corporations is to avoid anyone who can control them, expose them, counteract them, displace them, bankrupt them, or incarcerate their leaders? So what do? They now, and for many years, although they're getting better at it, they strategically plan our elections, strategically plan our government, strategically plan our military budget, which leads to strategically planning some of our foreign policy. They strategically planning the commercialization of childhood. They want to get them young and hooked. They strategically plan what goes into the air, water, and land. They strategically plan our genetic inheritances, try Monsanto there. They're strategically planning our future. They strategically plan our public budgets. They're strategically planning education, try to commercial and privatize it. They don't like public education. They're strategically planning everything. There are no off limits. There are no commercial free zones anymore. There used to be. They even commercialize religion. When you commercialize childhood, that's pretty raw. Now, they don't win every fight. There is some resistance, individual choice resistance, rejection. There are reform periods in our history. But when are we going to start strategically planning our future across the entire continuum, when we get 1% or so of people who are part of a serious society and who seriously take cognitive awareness of that word posterity, who seriously don't want to be cursed by their descendants, who seriously want to be good ancestors, who seriously don't give up on themselves, who seriously don't become profound cynics so they can make excuses for themselves and appear intellectually formidable with quips and satiric phrases. That's what we have to achieve. And a 1% level is very achievable. And it starts with one person, and then five person, and eight persons. Look what Maud Bartle did when she started. Duff Conacher, Tommy Douglas, you can name your own people. Look at their multiplier effect. Did they give up on themselves? Did they get discouraged? They had civic personalities that don't get discouraged. They're like good doctors. They don't get discouraged when they see disease and they go to work in hospitals. And too many people of good intention and direction get burnt out. And that's what happens when we emphasize charity over justice. Charity is very important. It ministers to people in desperate circumstances. People are hungry, people are sick, people are refugees, people are fearful, people need help, children need help. I'm not downgrading charity. I'm saying that if it is only charity, you're going to get the bureaucracies of charity, and you're going to get good people who started out at 18, 20, 21, idealistic. They go, they work in soup kitchens and so forth, and then they see that the society is delivering more and more people, and then it never ends. They're on a treadmill, and they burn out. And then they go to Young and Bloor. They join the commercial world. We've seen plenty of that. Justice prevents the conditions that create the need for charity. A society that has more justice is a society that needs less charity. Down to conversation, before we have a discussion, if I may, it all starts with conversation. And here's little exercises that I've come up with. When you say to people, have you grown up corporate? They say, what do you mean growing up corporate? I grew up male, I grew up female, I grew up Canadian, you know, I grew up a Hamilton soccer fan or whatever. I said, look, calm down. We all grow up corporate. If you know anybody who hasn't grown up corporate in North America, I'll show you a visiting Martian. We all are exposed to tens of thousands of ads. What do you mean? I got my own independent mind. I read the great progressive tracts of our forebears. All right. What comes to mind when I use the following words? What comes to your mind, oh skeptic? Ready? Yep. Crime, regulation, welfare, violence. Quick, tell me. Well, it's street crime, it's people lining up for welfare, it's government regulation, it's rape, war, you know, mugging. Yeah, that's true. Keep going. Well, what do you mean, keep going? Want me to give you more examples of abuse of women and minorities and crime in the streets, filling the supermax prisons that Mr. Harper wants to build? What else? Let's get quantitative here. By far, the greatest quantitative examples and conditions in those categories are corporate sourced. You cannot compare street crime totals with the fatalities that come out of corporate negligence, crime, and harmful technologies. No, I just gave you some examples of medical malpractice in the hospitals. In the U.S., 250 people a day, according to the Centers for Disease Control, die from hospital-induced infections. Preventable. Just couldn't get around to the protocols that would prevent it, like more rigorous requirement that nurses and doctors wash their hands between patients, for starters. So after a while, you give them the examples, and you say, gee, you know, corporations regulate ourselves far more than governments. You really think government regulates you like corporations? When was the last time you didn't sign a fine print contract? Anybody here who refuses to sign a fine print contract? Anybody here who takes an installment loan contract and a credit card agreement and an insurance policy and so on? Anybody say, oh, I'm crossing out some things here. Hey, I'm a consumer, consumer sovereignty. I'm doubling the warranty. Take that, Ford, right? I'm reducing my rent. Take that, big landlord in the new buildings here. No, we're serfs. It's called contract peonage, contract servitude. We've lost the fundamental conservative pillar of a democracy by conservative standards, freedom of contract. The law schools teach it 1 hour in the States. All the rest is negotiated contracts. That's where the jobs are. That is, contracts between companies, between government and companies, between labor unions and companies. That's where the money is. 99% contract peonage. That's what we sign. Corporate regulation, when they restrict the budgets of courts and civil tort trials, can't get there in time, and they're filled up with drug cases. When they put caps on damages for the most serious injuries of hazardous technologies and toxics, and they do it by legislative lobbying. When they buy politicians and rent politicians, they're not regulating you. Welfare, hands down. Look at the multi-trillion dollar corporate welfare of Wall Street in the 2008-09. You can't compare that with $300 a month welfare mothers. I mean, look what they have to look up to for ambition. Welfare, regulation, violence. It's not a contest. We have to get down to reality. The way societies are controlled is by myths. And the myths screen out reality in education year after year, in what we look on in television. They screen it out with entertainment, the Roman circus. They screen it out with lies, like what we were told to invade Iraq and that socicide. And they screen it out with inducing self-censorship, which is rampant, afraid to speak our minds. And they do it by suppressing the very reality that could pop to the surface. They destroy it, like things have happened in our history that are no longer visible. So let me end on this. One, we've got to start getting the civic skills going. We want new leaders. What if we had 10 Tommy Douglas? Can you imagine? Could Canada fit 10 Tommy Douglas? We want new leaders. They multiply themselves. The very few who have achieved what they've achieved is all the evidence of how important it is to develop civic skills and bring the families into it, not just pedagogy. Make it experiential, classroom to community. They learn about the community. Now they learn about virtual reality. They're looking at screens. They're totally addicted to screens now. They don't even know the nature in their community. We had a survey in our hometown in Connecticut about the natural artifacts, and they got the lake right. You know, it was right up on the hill, 7 miles around, so they couldn't miss that. And they got some hills. They missed the two rivers in the town because the rivers meant nothing to them. They were old industrial sewers, and they still haven't been cleaned up. But they don't even know where to go. They don't know where town hall is. They're all looking like this. This has got them. If Marx came back, he wouldn't say religion is the opiate of the people. He would say the smartphone is the opiate of the people, the stupid smartphone. You can't even go through campus in the United States and meet the eye of a student anymore. All right, I don't want to go over. Let me just end this. Here's where we grow up corporate almost 100%. If you ask your fellow Canadian, what do you own? And they'll say, you know, let's play a game. What do you own? Well, I own clothes. I own a car. I own a house, condo. I own stereos. I own computers. Yeah, keep going, keep going. Well, you know, I own trinkets. I own a little jewelry. I have a savings account. Yeah, keep going. And you get down to paper clips. And they say, keep going, keep going, keep going. There's nothing else I can say. What are you talking about? When was the first time anybody would say, I'm a part owner of the commons? I'm a part owner of the crown lands. I'm a part owner of the public airways. I am sure a part owner of most of the major new industries in Canada and the US, which wouldn't have been what they are today without trillions of dollars of taxpayer-funded research and development given to them free. Aerospace, biotech, pharmaceutical, containerization, computer, internet, and on and on and on. That's the conversation that starts igniting an awareness, an illumination, an increase in people's sense of their own significance. So it starts with the schools, civic education. It starts with mobilizing more choices on the ballot, like you have a viable Green Party. I mean, you have Elizabeth May. She's in the parliament. You may have more later. But you know, with all your infirmities, you do have more of a multiple-party system. But there's all kinds of things we can do when we organize well-named civic engagement groups that reflect majority opinion and that are spearheaded by people who are serious about why they're here on Earth, other than meeting their immediate necessities. And if you say, how do you get to 1%? One at a time, two at a time, six at a time, 20, 40, 60. That's exactly the way it was done for all the major changes in our country's history that spell the word justice. And I leave you with the great statement of Eugene Debs, the great labor leader in the United States. How many people have heard of him? He is in the history books. He's the kind of person who took a train from Philadelphia to talk to an open-air audience in Chicago, and 200,000 people showed up. He was near the end of his career, and he had been quoted as saying, "The pursuit of justice means the willingness to engage the adversaries so that you fail, fail, and fail until you succeed." You have to endure failure. You do not allow failure to discourage you. But at the end of his career, a reporter sauntered up to him. This is in the 1920s. And he said, he ran for president, and he was in jail. He got 1 million votes, and he probably had 3 million stolen from him. This was because he spoke out against World War I. Just spoke out against World War I. Sedition. That wouldn't happen today, fortunately. Things are better on the free speech front, although they've taken a little regress here in recent years. Anyway, the reporter asked him, "Mr. Debs, in your long career of fighting for working families, what's your biggest regret? Watch this." He looked at the reporter and he said, "My biggest regret? My biggest regret is under our Constitution, the American people can have almost anything they want, but it just seems that they don't want much of anything at all." In other words, when we allow our expectation levels to be pressed down by our own neglect or our own myopia or our own indulgence, the battle is over before it begins. Thank you. Can I have anybody want to start? Yes, ma'am.
Oh my God, I hate to follow you. That was really inspiring. Thank you. I took so many pages of notes. I wonder if you could talk about energy democracy. The province of Ontario is moving forward with rebuilding our aging nuclear fleet. And I know you have done work on energy issues before. They want to rebuild 10 reactors, no public consultation, no opportunity for public input except for the election day. And I wonder if you could speak to that.
Well, we started fighting nuclear power, which should never be allowed because it's impermissibly risky. Of course, it's right now compared with solar and natural gas and so on, it's uneconomic, it's uninsurable, it has to be guaranteed by the federal government because Wall Street will not fund a new nuclear plant without 100% guarantee. It's a national security problem from the get-go, you know, with all the fuel rods and pools of water. And it's unnecessary. We don't need it. And it's a terrible risk to future generations, hundreds of thousands of years of problems and waste. So the goal basically is stop it. And we did stop it in 1973 until a couple years ago. Not a single nuclear plant was ordered and put into operation. So we went from 117 nuclear plants in the U.S. To now it's about 97. They're closing them. They're not opening them. There are a couple unfinished ones, a couple just been canceled. The projection in 1970 was 1,000 nuclear plants. So that was grassroots power. And exposing the corporate socialism aspect of it, which nuclear power couldn't even begin without government insurance, without government loan guarantees, without free government research and development. Okay, so I would urge you to show that here in Canada, you know full well, wind power and solar photovoltaics and solar thermal prices are coming down, and that's the way to go. Just to even think of nuclear plant and a new nuclear plant in Ontario is a crime. Just to even think of it. But it's just a profit avenue for powerful forces who got the ear of the Parliament. Yes. Yes. Go ahead. Sorry. Yes. Go ahead. Oh, okay, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nader. Your address was even more than I expected, and I find it highly and marvelously stimulating. With reference to our own Prime Minister, Mr. Harper, the only thing I can think of in considering him is the following. It's no words. Can you suggest some other ways to get rid of this?
Yes, it's a little
character.
It's a little more verbal. Yes, when I look at his record and what he's done, and it's all been tabulated here. I mean, his suppression of speech, his criminalization of speech and anti-terrorism bills, and his militarism, his F-35 boondoggle, his following like a toady the Washington Empire. His destruction of Canada's role as peacemakers, his diversion of public budgets, his corporate tax breaks, his corporate subsidies, his devastation of the environment, his stripping of the social safety net, his statement to an American audience in 2007 when he said, "Before we're through, you won't recognize Canada," on and on and on. All I can think of him is that Stephen Harper is a corporation masquerading as a human being.
Ah, bravo. Bravo.
Yes.
So you talked a lot about community organization, and I thought it was quite inspiring. But I think a lot of people that are trying to advocate causes today have to deal with the additional challenge that now there's a geographic separation between cause and effect. So I was wondering if you had any advice for what consumer rights activists should do to deal with the challenges of networked global capitalism.
Well, you mean just from a consumer point of view, other than divert their dollars into local businesses that are more locally accountable? They're not chains. They're not. I have never been in a Walmart. I have never been in a McDonald's, and I've never been in a Starbucks. Has anybody never been in all three? Right. And let me give you an example. My sister raised her hand. So. Works in the family. And I couldn't be dragged into them, because I know what they're displacing. I know what they stand for. I know how they mislead people about what they're doing. And I know about the concentration of wealth and how many family businesses they're displacing and so forth. So that's one way. And I want to emphasize that, because I can tell you there are four or five of the most left groups you can imagine. And when you get expense checks from them, like a left publisher in California, like Democracy Now! In New York, like the Actors Pension Fund, you get checks from them. And they're on J.P. Morgan banks and Wells Fargo banks. And there's a labor bank in New York. You know, there's Amalgamated Labor Bank. They just don't use it. The second is something that Duff Conacher knows a lot about, and you might want to contact him. It's called CUBS. And here in Canada, you can actually do it easier in the U.S., where you provincially or nationally, you You pass a bill which requires all regulated industries, when they send you their billing envelope every month or whatever, to put an insert inviting you to join your own independent consumer group, which then you hire economists, organizers, lawyers, publicists. We did this, for example, in Illinois, and 180,000 people joined in less than a year, and we had experts negotiated with Commonwealth Edison for a $1.3 billion refund for overcharging them on their nuclear plants. So you have really experts and advocates and champions, and this could spread throughout the whole country. You do not have a constitutional objection to that. We had a very bad 6-3 decision that put a monkey wrench into that. If you talk to Duff Conacher on that, you'll see how easy it is to do it in Canada, at least from a legal point of view. It doesn't cost the companies anything. It's no extra postage. You strip them of their objections, but you provide a facility for enough people to band together to put the advocates up front, a seat at the table. The third thing that needs to be done is the alliance of consumer rights with labor rights, small taxpayer rights. And that's when it really gets powerful, and it has a much more political effect. And that's unions consume, and consumers work, right? And they all pay taxes, right? So they ought to be one.
Thank you.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Mr. Nader, thank you very much. I enjoyed the talk that you have given very much. I just have a question. You know, this actually relates to our election that's coming up in October, because you mentioned, you know, Wall Street, and you talked a lot about corporations, but it's been my observation, you know, especially looking at the past elections here in Canada, there's a problem that I would say is with this, it's a tactic really that's been used by the Harper government, this focus on the economy as a scare tactic, and I've also seen that used in the United States. And the problem I can say also is that, you know, increasingly over the last few decades, more and more people are going to the stock market, to investments. And when people feel that they have stock, you know, possibly in these big corporations, that also has an effect on voters' minds. And these may not be diehard conservatives. These may be middle of the road types, even people a bit to the left, but you know, people with a certain income that are thinking about their futures, retirement. Yeah. This is I see it as a big problem actually, and I'd like to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, that's often said. You get them committed into the system, therefore they don't want the system to be disrupted. The problem is that when Wall Street collapses and the cyclical collapse, that rebuts that argument, right? I mean, oh, look at the pension funds crashed and the mutual funds crashed. The second thing is you divide and rule the corporate governance process. That is, you basically say to a lot of these companies that don't give dividends, but they give stock buybacks so they can set up the frame to get higher stock option values. But they're spending 80, you cannot believe the percent, I don't have it right now, of corporate profits that are used for stock buybacks. But it's over 50% of corporate profits are used, which is totally useless, totally unproductive. It shows that they don't know what to do with their money, like giving workers more pay, Walmart, like making their pension more solid, like giving straight out cash dividends to the shareholders. So you can put them on the defensive that way, because they have a conflict of interest against their own shareholders, see? And the third is that the bigger issues that I talked about always take precedent. I mean, if you're unemployed or underemployed, that's the top thing in your mind. It's not whether you have $2,500 in a mutual fund that is investing in, you know, Nortel or something.
Yes, but I just would say that in the previous election we had here, I think it was very important, and it might have made a difference, for example, here in Ontario, you know, between having an NDP government and a Conservative one. I totally understand what you're saying. That's, in fact, another issue.
No,
is,
you have to. I'm sorry. We have to. Yeah. We're running out of time. I'm sorry. Can you have it there?
Hi, Mr. Nader. Hopefully an easy question for you. You were successful back in the 60s of putting through the product safety legislation through Congress and everything else. Would you be able to do that with today's lobby groups and so on? Do you think you'd be successful now in Washington?
It'd be much more difficult. A, the media is more conglomeratized, number one, even though there's the internet. Number two, the labor unions are weaker. They were our help. And number three, we have different people in Congress. But we all allowed this to happen. I mean, you had some of the greatest members of Congress be defeated in 1980 by people who were mesmerized by Reagan and the Iran, the hostage thing. And they parked into retirement Senator Nelson, Senator Magnuson, Senator Church. So we got to be a little smart. When I was campaigning for the presidency, I would ask voters, I'd say, give me 10 criteria of a smart voter. And he said, we've never been asked that before. I said, you know why you haven't been asked that before? Because all about every politician who's ever asked for your vote flatters you. They flatter you and flatter you and flatter you, and they flummox you, and they mislead you in the process. So don't be flattered. So we don't rigorously do our homework. It's only a few hours to find out what the record is of these politicians asking for your vote. So that's where the problem is. It is harder today, but still, just give me 1% on anything. You want to cut the Pentagon budget? The Pentagon budget isn't even auditable, by the way. They can't even get their books to the government accounting office. Just audit it. Year after year, $600-700 billion unaudited. They wonder why they can't find $9 billion they spent in Iraq in the first 4 months of the invasion. You don't think we can mobilize that? I don't even need 1%. Give me 50,000 people scattered in who would fight that? They'd be fools to try to argue that down. Every small business knows they have to be audited. They got to know where the money goes. It's a lot easier than we think. You got to keep saying that, so that people can say, what are you really talking about? Are you Pollyannish? No, it's a lot easier than we think. I mean, I don't want to boast at all, but you know, we took on the auto companies. 1%? Are you kidding? We were lucky to have 400 people. I asked the expert who led the way against tobacco, Mike Perchuk. He was in Congress, he was the Federal Trade Commission, and I said, at the peak of the opposition against the tobacco industry, litigation, potential regulation, public disgrace, so on. At the peak of the opposition, no smoking airlines, buses, trains, no smoking retail, you know, when it reached its peak and then it started breaking through, how many full-time people pulled this off in the United States of America in terms of doctors, scientists, organizers, publicists, litigators, reporters, 60 Minutes, and so on? He said, no more than 1,000. Okay? Surgeon General's reports. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Mr. Nader. Thank you so much. And I just wanted to say that, you know, some of the institutions that you built are flourishing bastions of political organizing all throughout Canada, speaking directly about the PERGs.
Yes.
So I actually have in my hand a publication from the local University of Toronto PERG with me.
Good.
But I wanted to bring up something, and it's your thoughts on the corporatization of the university, because I know you're being hosted by the Monk School of Global Affairs, and I'm sorry, I'm just going to say that while they host many great events. They've also been the center of many very significant foreign policy moves of the Canadian government, including the complete derailing of the roundtables process to create accountability for Canadian mining companies operating abroad. many of these things are actually listed in the article in this publication. But I just would like you to talk about the corporatization, the threat of the corporatization of the university, and how while academic freedom might still exist, these institutions are used to make major changes that are not progressive at all, that are completely, you know, alongside Harper's agenda most recently by, you know, being against the Iran deal and all these other things. But I just would like to
Yeah, well, I'm very sensitive to that. I just spoke at Harvard Law School, my alma mater, which I called, as a student, a high-priced tool factory for Wall Street. It is heavily corporatized. They have good clinics for immigrants, for tenants, for poor people. But then they have no jobs. There are no jobs out there for people who graduate and want to make a full-time career of these. There's very few jobs. The jobs are corporate, mostly. And corporatization of universities are everywhere. It's getting worse. It's up to the faculty, especially, to be a bastion against it. People want to contribute and set up in their names institutes. There should be no strings attached. I understand the University of Toronto has a protocol on that in writing that you might want to examine. But it's also up to the students to constantly do this. It isn't the old-fashioned, you know, we're going to give you money in a dark room if you support the mining industry. It begins to insinuate itself in several forms. Self-censorship by people like professors and deans. And they do it very intellectually, though, self-censorship. There are taboos, you see. What are the taboos?
In secret.
Pardon?
It bypassed the governing council.
Yes.
And it was passed in secret. There's a Freedom of Information quest threatened. Anyways, there's a whole story
about that. Secrecy's another tool. The fear of Harper and Revenue Canada and a lot of nonprofit groups. Have they gone into yours yet? They've gone into a lot of others. That's pretty scandalous. And so you do, as students, you have to save these universities from themselves, because you're the ones who can ask the impertinent questions. You're the ones who don't have an axe to grind. You're the ones who can help the professors who are standing taller. They don't like to be intellectually indentured like that. So it's very good. I'm glad you raised it. This is a public interest research group. It's called PIRGS. We started them in the United States. They're in 23 states. And I'm very happy that U of T has got an active one. There's one in BC, even one in Alberta, I heard, and elsewhere. It's basically students petitioning to give $5, $6 or whatever, I don't know what it is, or from student government. They set up their own nonprofit entity, and they advocate for a better Canada or a better Ontario. And they're heavily environmental, but they can do other things as well. And I'm glad you're into the subject you just talked about. Because if the universities are not free, that's a tremendous loss to the society. You know, if the Special Assistant on National Security, John Brennan, for Barack Obama, can be invited to Harvard Law School in 2011 and deliver a 45-minute address saying that everything they're doing in the war on terrorism, drones, Guantanamo, invasions, Iraq, everything they do is legal and constitutional. And they didn't lay a hand on him in terms of the question period. They gave him an ovation. What does that tell you about the Harvard Law School? See? So the universities are hugely important. In many dictatorships, that's the first arena of rebellion, right? That's why the first thing they do is shut down the universities in Mexico and Peru and elsewhere in the past. So all power to you. You can basically tell them that here at the University of Toronto, we want untrammeled, uncensored, unretributed, free speech, free study. We want our subjects to probe the taboos and the dark corners of our society. And above all, we want the university to stand against any kind of official restraint and oppression. That's extremely important to do that. And there's some wonderful faculty around the country who have done this. They've written great books, but they're often lonely voices, and they shouldn't be. Yes.
Hi. I've been looking for a talented, courageous American lawyer for some time.
And I thought I got one when Obama got elected. But as you, perhaps I was disappointed. But now then I see you, and I say, why not? Ralph Nader. The question remains that the world has seen some war crimes from son of a Bush and son of a Blair. And why are they not being brought before International Criminal Court for their war crimes? And who will do that if not you?
Yes, we know Ramsey Clark, was former Attorney General, has tried to do that. He goes all over the world. He's a great hero. He's blocked by the fact that we really don't participate in these international war crime tribunals. That's just for people from the third world, you know, dictators from the third world who get apprehended. And that is damaging the credibility of the international court very seriously. We refuse to adhere to that treaty. So it's pretty hard for Ramsey Clark, who would be the first to do what you say, and bring the United States, for whom he was once the Attorney General under Lyndon Johnson, to account. We did lose a case once when we mined the harbors of Nicaragua, and we just brushed it off. Like, they don't have jurisdiction over the red, white, and blue, land of the free, home of the brave, USA. So we want international law for others, but not our allies and not ourselves. So I would look up his website. Just look up Ramsey Clark, and you'll get a lot of leads to see whether you can follow your concerns further.
Is there something you can do?
No, there's nothing I can do. I mean, I don't work in the international law area, number one. Number two, I got enough to do for 80 hours a week, or 90 hours a day, whatever you want to say. You go to people who've already got experience in it. I can speak out on it, and I have. Hey, listen. When I was a presidential candidate in 2004, I stood in front of the White House in Lafayette Square with C-SPAN, and I delivered a 45-minute criminal indictment of George W. Bush and Dick Cheney. It didn't make page one of the New York Times, though. But I mean, I took it right to the limit.
Is it on your website?
Yeah, it's on the C-SPAN. It's what's the equivalent here? Yeah, you can. They have it all archived on there. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Mr. Nader. My mother came to this country in 1968, a card-carrying socialist member from Guyana, and as a child, I got my civic education in front of the television set with two men, Stephen Lewis, and you. And I just wanted to sort of discuss more about this idea of parents and how they can further educate their children on sort of civic topics. I work for a private school, the University of Toronto Schools, and I speak to parents every day. They are concerned about their children. I speak to not just rich parents, I talk to parents from all the spectrum, and they seem lost. And I, you know, if I could get something from you to sort
sure.
of add.
Sure, very specifically, I know exactly what you're talking about. By the way, when I talk about civic skills, schools, and parents, that doesn't mean you drop everything you're doing and wait for them to mature 20 years. When you're doing parents, like work against commercialization of childhood, and you're doing civic skills, you become more active on contemporary issues day after day, and you get more people with you. You meet parents you never thought were 200 meters away in your neighborhood, in our atomized society, right? All right, the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives in Ottawa has enormously good material, right on the educational issue. Okay. My second cousin is Erica Shaker, and she's in charge. Runs in a family, you see? And she has very good material on Canadian schools, Canadian education, what's happening, what could happen, what should happen. The other thing, and they have all kinds of material on their website. They have a monthly paper, Monitor it's called. The editor of this was the editor of the Monitor
okay.
for for CCPA, Ed Finn. Second, if you want to get 7 minutes of agitation every week free, just get my weekly column. You can't believe how hard it is to tell people. You see them 20 months later or something. You say, here, they ask a question like you know. They say, okay, get my weekly column, all kinds of topics. Go to nader.org. You know what the beginning stuff is. Mm-hmm. Nader.org. You sign up. You get it automatically every week. 7 minutes of agitation, 7 minutes saying what you can do, it's not just agitation. And then, these are real hardcore progressives, right? 5 months later, hey, how'd you like my column? Oh, I haven't done it yet. I can't tell you how many times, it's not just me. The overload is, all information is cheapened now. Books are cheapened. Young people, you give them a book, what's this? Burdens my backpack. Used to give them a book, it was really something. It was respected their intelligence. Thank you very much. These are progressive activists. They don't stay in touch with each other. They're all silos. The leading ones are pursuing their wonderful careers. They write, they speak, they do very good things. They don't connect with one another. If you don't aggregate, you don't have a movement. You have to aggregate.
So, thank you, Mr. Nader.
Okay. That's the key to our website, by the way, nader.org. And if you want another one, you go to citizen.org. You can see how early we got that domain name.
We have no limit but time, so I want to thank all of you so much for coming, and I want to ask you to join me in the most open-hearted thanks that you can give.